afternoon. Thank you for being here today. My name is Tim Weinhold, and I have the distinct privilege to introduce Professor Travis Morris, Executive Director of the Colby Symposium and Director of Norwich Peace and War Center, to open the 23rd Annual William E. Colby Military Writers Symposium. Dr. Morris is an Associate Professor of Criminology and Criminal Justice here at Norwich. He holds a PhD from the University of Nebraska and an MS in Criminal Justice from Eastern Kentucky University, and a BA in Criminology from Northern Illinois University. He also served as a Ranger Qualified Infantry Officer with the 10th Mountain Division, U.S. Army, and a police officer in Lexington, Kentucky. His research interests include violent extremism, propaganda analysis, information warfare, and comparative justice systems. He has also published on the relationship between policing, peacekeeping, counterterrorism, counterinsurgency, and has conducted ethnographic research in Yemen and Israel. His recent book, Dark Ideas, focuses on how neo-Nazi and violent jihadi ideologues have shaped modern terrorism. Last year, he directed the NU National Championship Team in the National Collegiate Competition, sponsored by the U.S. Department of State and Department of Homeland Security, aimed at countering domestic and foreign online radicalization. He also leads NU students on a peace and conflict field studies, Israel and Macedonia. Without further ado, Dr. Travis Morris.
Thanks, Tim. Welcome. It's great to see everybody here, and authors and panelists, thank you so much for being here. We're extremely excited. So, welcome to the 23rd Annual William E. Colby Writers Symposium at Norwich University in Northfield, Vermont. This event is a signature event for Norwich University's Peace and War Center, and this symposium is unique and the only one of its kind in existence at an American institution. Over its 23 years, the symposium has brought some of the most prominent military, intelligence, international affair writers of our time to Central Vermont. The symposium is designed to educate, to enlighten, to challenge, and to inspire. And as always, this symposium is designed to be relevant to each of you sitting out here and watching us online, and has never avoided the hard issues central to our public's understanding. So a bit of context for each of you that are familiar with the symposium. Back in 1996, the symposium was conceived by co-founders W.E. Griffith and Carlo Desse, with the support of former North President Major General Russell Todd. This event was seen as a way to bring influential writers and their ideas and their expertise to North University. So in the past, we focused on a myriad of topics that range from PTSD to Vietnam, to Afghanistan, to the war's impact on families. This year, our focus, as you can see in your program, is winning the war, the loss of peace, the U.S. legacy, and Iraq. This is a very relevant and current topic that for those of you who will be entering military service, this topic will directly impact you. Sitting before you, you have some of the globe's leading authorities on the subject, and I don't say that lightly. We are very fortunate to have each member sitting on the panel, and we hope that you appreciate each of you that may not be familiar with the backgrounds because of your majors, but we grant that we are very fortunate to have them here at this university, and we'll hear from them shortly. So before I introduce the moderator, I'd like to recognize and thank several people who make this event possible. So if you could please, when I call your name, please stand. President Richard Snyder, and let's hold all applause to the end. The interim president and CEO of the Pritzker Military Museum and Library, John Schwan. And I would also like to note that the symposium is made available through the generosity and supportership of the Pritzker Military Museum and Library. U.S. retired General Gordon Sullivan, class of 1959. U.S. Army retired Major General and North President Emeritus Russell Todd, class of 1950. I'd also like to thank all those alumni supporters who are on and off campus, so let's give them all a round of applause. I'd also like Specifically, we'd like to welcome Colonel Ron Loss, Ms. Marsha Schultz, and Colonel Jerry Morlock. Before I introduce our moderator, just a couple of housekeeping issues. I'm sure all of you have already done. First, make sure that you turn off your cell phones or put them on vibrate. Just a reminder for the guests, with tickets to tonight's dinner, there is a venue change. For those of you that have attended in the past, it's been here in Plumlee, it's over the National Guard Armory. So don't worry if you show up here, there's a sign that will redirect you where you need to go. And after the panel, the authors will be signing books in the Milano Ballroom, which is directly across us at 4:30. So if you have questions, comments, and you'd like to buy and purchase the book, which we would like for you to do, please do so. Our moderator for today's panel is Sarwar Keshmeri. Sarwar Keshmeri is an adjunct professor of political science, and he's an applied research fellow at the Peace and War Center at March University. And he's also a fellow for the Foreign Policy Association. His Independence Day course at March focuses on U.S. grand strategy. He's an author and current affairs commentator and is noted for his expertise on U.S.-EU relations, as well as NATO. A former international businessman, he has served as a communications advisor to several Fortune 100 companies, and he brings a global business perspective to his work in U.S. foreign policy and national security strategy. He's authored two books, NATO 2.0, Reboot or Delete, and America and Europe After 9/11 in Iraq, The Great Divide. He speaks frequently before businesses, foreign policy associations, and military offices. He's also on television and frequent radio appearances, and he's a regular writer, and you may have read some of his work not knowing it, for the U.S. News and World Report and the Huffington World Post. He is the author of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization and EU's Common Security and Defense Policy Intersecting Trajectories. He's written several publications for numerous articles, and currently he hosts the China in Focus podcast series on U.S.-China relations for the Carnegie Corporation of New York. Please join me in giving Sarwar Keshmeri a warm welcome.
So, good afternoon, everybody. This is the second of the trilogy that Professor Morris and the Peace and War Center have set up for this event, annual event. Won the war, lost the peace. Last year we talked about the First World War. This year we are talking about Iraq, the legacy of Iraq. And next year we'll be completing that trilogy and talking about what of the future. So, I'll introduce the panel in a moment, but I did want to say that any one of these panelists would make an event, a major event, and have all four of them here together is quite a deal. So I want you to realize that and enjoy it, and make sure you have questions, because this is your chance to get all of the questions answered that you've thought about as far as Iraq. What I would like to do is talk to you a little bit about the atmosphere in the country when the Iraqi invasion took place. Right. So I recognize that many of the people in this room were in the first grade or second grade or third grade when the Iraqi invasion took place. In fact, I recognize some of you from the playing field in kindergarten. So how does this happen? What is this? Some of you may think that the Iraqi invasion should never have happened. Others of you may think that it should have happened. But regardless of whether you think not, yes, I think you need to understand where the country was when all of this began. And that's what I'd like to spend a few minutes on. And you know, it's almost a trite statement these days that 9/11 changed the world. Right? You've all heard that. 9/11 changed the world, changed the country, changed the world. So what you're looking at here is a view of Manhattan a few days before 9/11. And you can see from the cockpit of this airplane that it's aimed directly at the World Trade Center. And the World Trade Center is that rectangular, square-looking building straight ahead, if I'm looking at this. In the center is the Empire State Building, and then there are other buildings that go on, but there's the World Trade Center. And it was as beautiful a day as this one is today. And my offices then were just a few blocks from the Empire State Building, so we were about roughly six miles from 9/11. Right, and it was a day just like this, beautiful, people going to work. And then two jets commanded by terrorists were taking them over, crashing the World Trade Center. Now, this is a shot a few minutes after. So there's office paper floating down, there's furniture floating down. This is the first, the northern tower. Soon a plane would hit the southern tower, and all hell would break loose. By the way, a half hour after this film was taken, it wouldn't be paper coming down. It would be people coming down, jumping out of windows, preventing themselves from being burned because they couldn't escape. So this is a seminal moment that all of you need to keep in your mind. Now think about the impact of this. And you can see the nervousness and the fright in the person's voice as they're talking about this. That's what it looked like after it was done. Now, every New Yorker has their own story about 9/11, the World Trade Center. Every American knows where they were. I do too. I met my wife not far from the Trade Center. We had our first dinner at the World Trade Center. We attended a lot of functions at the Windows on Top of the World, which is a restaurant on the top floor of the World Trade Center. And I tell you, I walked up as far as I could go 3 days later, and I could still smell the debris from the World Trade Center. A line of trucks coming in from New Jersey with grim drivers, American flags, carrying what remained of the World Trade Center out. And all I could think of was, how could I go somewhere and strangle somebody with my bare hands? And by the way, I've spent my life being trained, educated by Jesuits. So if I felt that way, I think others probably felt a lot worse. So that's kind of where this story begins. And I'm going to take you just a little further, right, in this. So 9/11 happens, world changes, country changes. 2 months after that, President Bush sent a special forces team with a specially armed CIA team to Afghanistan. And there's a very wonderful book called The Horse Soldiers, which you should read. It talks about how within a few short months, they put the Taliban to flight. They had the first cavalry charge to put in the saddles, all for an expense of $70 million. It sounds like a lot of money. But that's what it costs. And then somehow two years later, we changed direction and invaded Iraq. Right? Some things I want to know from the panel are, why did we do it? Did we have to do it? I mean, why did we change focus? Those are the kinds of things I'd like to learn, and I urge you to keep thinking about your questions. So we invaded Iraq, and it was thought that it would all be over in 2 months. In fact, 2 months later, the President of the United States went on a carrier and said, hey, it's over, mission accomplished. period.
So first up is Ms. Elizabeth Ells. She is majoring as a civil engineer and was graduated in 2018. Herself.
Imagine a world with no basic human rights for its people, no police force or education system. For some, this is a reality, one that the Iraqi people face each day. Between January and June 2013 alone, over 2,800 children were killed due to violence in the country. With $180 million US dollars and funds, only 6 out of 142 health clinics slated for construction have been built, and less than half of New York's population can claim reliable access to potable water. That is 18.6 million people. One out of every 3 Iraqis says restoring infrastructure, not job creation or amending the Constitution, should be the government's top priority. And so far, the total reconstruction tab has climbed to $45 billion. With the country ranking 2nd for last in health and 10th for last in education, I am here to understand why after 15 years of American occupation, there is still such a lack of social infrastructure in Iraq.
Next up is Mr. Benjamin Pulisgas, who is a chemistry major, graduating in 2019.
As the naturalist Charles Darwin said, it is not the strongest species that survives, nor the most intelligent. It is the one that is most adaptable to change. In science, adaptability is a key aspect of how we are able to make necessary changes to ideas that have held for extended periods of time. As I have learned from the chemistry department here at Norwich, new theories are created every year to explain phenomena from data. Because of the advances within medicine, there have been scores of American lives saved from the horrors of war. With the tragedy that befell the American people on September 11, 2001, the world changed. America went from a state of peace and stability to a state of war and confusion. Frequently, fighting was done home to home with people who were traditionally considered non-combatants. With the war in Iraq, an entire generation has grown up with a major conflict being part of their everyday lives one way or another. As a government, the United States needs to be able to adapt to new circumstances within our current style of warfare. I would like to learn today why, with the largest defense budget in the world, American policymakers have not focused enough attention on adapting to this new style of war.
Next up is Mr. Spencer Duhamel, English major, graduating 2018.
Hello, Norwich students, faculty, and distinguished members of the panel. First, I would like to draw your attention to the monitors behind me. My reading of this picture is two children whose future looks unclear, sitting in the rubble of their now-destroyed city, no parents in sight, and no one to help pick up the pieces. These boys are living on the street, which is an incredibly unfortunate reality, a reality that haunts some 600,000 Iraqi children. As an English major here in Norwich, I have developed a sense of what elements make us human. This list includes romance, desire, identity, power, and parenting, all attributes still missing from Iraqi life today. I would like to draw attention to arguably the greatest problem, the problem of children growing up in the world without knowing anything but the devastation and loss caused by the war in Iraq. So, I am here to learn today how, with a $650 billion defense budget, the United States plans on caring for the mental health and well-being of Iraqi children.
Next up is Ms. Erin Proctor, nursing major, graduating in 2019.
500,000 U.S. troops who have served in the war in Iraq and Afghanistan suffer from PTSD. Fortunately, due to advancing medical care on the warfront, soldier survival rates are increasing, leading to an emerging need for treatment of psychological injuries. As a nursing major, we learn to look at people as a whole, the physical as well as the emotional and mental. Sometimes in war, only the physical is seen, the missing limbs and the massive scars. But there is so much more to people than just the physical. The psychological needs to be addressed and cared for as well. But this does not just affect the soldiers that return. It affects all the people involved. I am here today to ask why so many people are being left to fend for themselves, and why we place more value on guns and ammo over the minds of those who wield them. Thank you.
Last but not least, Mrs. Fabian Furr, physics major, graduating 2019.
Show people as one thing, as only one thing, over and over again, and that is what they become. African author Chimamanda Adichie warns us of the dangers of accepting a single cultural story as an overgeneralization of a region, a country, a people, and how consequential cultural misunderstanding could have dangerous repercussions. This is especially relevant with regard to those who come from a completely different social background, like American and Iraq. It is difficult but imperative to understand the complexity of intricate global differences. I hope to hear from the panel more on their own thoughts and experiences of the broad variety of human challenges they are familiar with, and what, in their opinion, is missing in American doctrine overseas. How can we accomplish our goals without losing the trust of the people we are trying to help?
Thanks very much. You know, I've been so busy rehearsing with the students that I forgot that they need to also be rehearsing me, and I'm very conveniently forgotten as Emma Hunker. So let me invite Ms. Emma Hunker here, mechanical engineering major.
That's okay. Good afternoon. A car stops at a makeshift checkpoint, cutting across a muddy back street. A man appears, stops the car, and asks, "Are you Sunni or Shia?" The car driver answers and the man says, "Wrong answer. Get him." A door swings open and out come five men to take his life. There is a moment of silence before a woman calls them in for dinner. This is an actual account from a reporter on the ground of one boy and his five brothers, all between the ages of 6 to 12. 3 weeks prior, these boys had seen their teacher killed in the same way and thus began making games with it. Not only do the children of Iraq see Iraqis killed by their own soldiers, they see the American soldiers who seem to do the exact same thing. Think back to your own childhood and your own parents. And what I would like to know today is whether or not American soldiers need to be exposed to these situations before they enter another land. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Bunker. Well, it's time now for me to introduce our panelists. I will then ask them a question myself. And as soon as I start asking them my question, that'll be your cue to line up before microphones that will be placed on the floor. There are squares drawn by the microphones. If you would step into the squares when you speak, so you'll be at the right distance. So let me now introduce our expert panel. So, to my extreme left is Mr. Saifuddin Abdul Rahman. Saifuddin Abdul Rahman is Vice President at IWG, a U.S. firm providing consulting, logistics, and construction work in Iraq. He has held senior posts in the government of Iraq, helped engineer Iraq's election law during the days of the Iraqi Governing Council, served as the Director General of the Parliament Research Directorate, participated in the negotiations on the Status of Forces Agreement with the United States. Next to him is Ms. Emma Skye. She is the Director of Yale Greenberg World Fellows, a Senior Fellow at the Yale University's Jackson Institute, where she teaches Middle East politics. She is the author of Unraveling, High Hopes and Missed Opportunities in Iraq. Skye served as advisor to the commanding general of U.S. forces in Iraq from 2007 to 2010, as advisor to the commander of NATO's International Security Assistance Force in Afghanistan. In 2006, as advisor to the U.S. Security Coordinator for the Middle East Peace Process in 2005, and as a governing coordinator of Kirkuk for the Coalition Provisional Authority 2003-2004. Next to her is Mr. Andrew Basevich, grew up in Indiana, graduated from West Point, Princeton, served in the U.S. Army, became an academic, and is now a writer. He's the author, co-author or editor of a dozen books, among them American Empire, The New American Militarism, Limits of Power, Washington Rules, Breach of Trust, and most recently, America's War for the Greater Middle East, A Military History. And then, Mr. Alan Kane is an award-winning author and noted speaker on terrorism, 21st century security matters, counterinsurgency, counterterrorism, strategic communications, political Islam, cultural understanding, and irregular warfare, and Middle Eastern geopolitical issues. King has advised congressional leaders, served as an advisor to senior leaders in the Department of State and Defense. In July 2004, King returned from Iraq after spending 16 months as a Civil Affairs Battalion commander, and then as the Deputy Director of the Office of Provincial Outreach, Coalition Provisional Authority, Baghdad, Iraq. He's the author of Twice Armed, An American Soldier's Battle for Hearts and Minds. So that's your panel. And this is your chance to ask all those questions you've been wanting to ask. And as you line up before the microphones, let me ask a question myself. I'd like to start with Mr. Serpentine and then go around the panel. And what I'd like to ask is if each one of you, the United States is an international power, right? So the United States has interests all around the world. But what I'd like to know from each of you is, what is the remaining national, vital national interest that the United States has in Iraq? Does it have any now? What would make a commander-in-chief send these people to a country? What is our vital national interest in Iraq? So please, go ahead.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here at Norwich University. Thank you for having me. This has been a great program. Appreciated the questions that we had yesterday. I think this is quite a challenging question, but I want to revert back to something Colin Powell said when asked about this particular situation. I think he talked about what the pottery barn rule, and that was you break it, you own it. And essentially, at this point in time, that's it. We broke it. We are responsible for the initial and then the later situations, and that essentially is one of the most fundamental reasons why we own it and should own it. Another economic component to this, and I think that this ties into some of my work personally, and you know, it's been said that we were there for the oil, and I think that that's a really simplistic argument, and I think the way to look at it is oil is not necessarily what we want, but what we need is to continue to have stability in the energy markets overall from an economic perspective. And making sure that we are still in the Middle East plays a fundamental role in ensuring that stability in the energy markets because of the amount of energy that's in that particular region, be it Iraq or around Iraq.
Thank you.
Thank you. And it really is an honor to be here at Norwich University. You asked a question about vital interests, and in the 24 hours that I've been here, a number of students have come up to me and spoken about Israel and how they go on field trips out to Israel, Palestine. And Israel remains a vital interest to the United States, and Israel's security remains something that is never taken for granted. And we can see in recent weeks the security threat to Israel continues to change. Before it was very much a focus on terrorism. Now the challenge is becoming the struggle that's going on between Israel and Iran. And you can see this playing out at the moment inside Syria. So Israel remains a vital security interest, a vital national interest to the United States.
Thank you, Mr. Basevich.
Oh, I too am very grateful to be here. And actually, at lunchtime, an additional reason why I'm so grateful, they gave us this little card, and I am told that if I go to the gift shop, I can get $50 worth of Norwich swag. It happens to be that I need a new sweatshirt, and I will have it before the sun goes down. So I would argue that we have no vital interests in this region. We have interests that are of far greater importance, whether we're talking about addressing the implications of the rise of China, implications of climate change, growing threats in the realm of cyber. But I think the reason we did what we did in the wake of 9/11 is that the 9/11 attack was a direct assault on a fundamental conviction held by most of our fellow citizens, and certainly sustained by people who work in Washington. And that fundamental conviction is the myth of American exceptionalism, that we are the chosen people. We are God's chosen people. We are the agents of history. History has a purpose. And our responsibility is to bring history to its foreordained conclusion, which will occur when the rest of the world believes what we believe. So 9/11 directly challenged that notion. And therefore, 9/11 required a violent and concerted response to demonstrate that the questions raised by the events of 9/11 simply were not true, that through the concerted use of military power, not simply in Iraq, but in the places that were to come after Iraq, we would demonstrate to ourselves and to the rest of the world beyond the shadow of a doubt that we are God's chosen people. Alas, here we are, all these years later, in that effort to sustain this myth have not worked. And I think really the greatest challenge incumbent upon us today as citizens is to finally come around to realizing that that myth is a great lie and that trying to sustain it does great harm to ourselves and indeed in places like Iraq does great harm to others as well.
I am so happy to be back in Norwich and get to see some old friends and faces, and I appreciate the invitation to return. I will tell you that what we did in Iraq was like hitting a beehive, and when the bees started to swarm, we turned to run, and there was no water to jump into. And so when I was here previously, 2008, 2009, I got to tell you some great war stories, and I was told once that nothing runs a great war story like eyewitnesses. And I've got two of them on the panel with me that share the same ground, so the stories may not be as good this year as they were in the past. But with all that being said, the Iraq is an interest that we have a responsibility to. But I don't think, as Andrew pointed out, I don't think it's as vital as some of the other interests that are growing around the globe, and China being one of those. And while Russia is a concern and one that's pushing on us, particularly in the Middle East, in Syria, is one that we have to worry about. But we do have a responsibility to Iraq. But we have to remember, with all the stories and questions that the students asked, it is now a sovereign nation. And we don't get to just walk in and impose our ideas. We have to take from Iraq what they want from us. And that may not be what we consider in our best interest, but one that we're going to have to learn to work within.
So you all need to be thinking about questions. The microphones are up. I have a couple more, but please step out to the microphones, those who have questions. And so the question I want to ask now is about this so-called Sunni-Shia divide. right? It's in headlines. Everyone now knows about it. Before 9/11, nobody had heard what a Sunni was or a Shia was, much less what Iraq was. So now we talk about the Sunni-Shia divide. And what I want to ask you, interestingly, three of these panelists, with the exception of Mr. Basevich, all three others, were all in Iraq at the same time. So some of their perspectives are formed in that crucible that they serve together. But what I'd like to ask is, Sunni Shias lived together in Iraq for years and years. I mean, there were minor tests here, minor tests there, but there was no divide. And there are some of the people that I've talked to who say this divide really started when the United States overthrew Iraq, the government in Iraq, and then had to form a new government, and then decided to have numbers of Sunnis, numbers of Shia, number of Kurds, and therefore injected this kind of religious, interest in the governing bodies. So the United States basically is responsible for creating this divide, which is previously a tiff, but not a divide. Would anyone of you like to take a shot at that?
Let me tell a personal story to start this off. It's very interesting to be, my family is originally from Mosul, the northern Iraq, which you've heard about because of ISIS, but you should have heard about because of its history. So I'm of a Sunni background, and my aunt happens to be married to a surgeon who is Shia. Living in western Baghdad in 2004, a place called Amriya. And I was a Sunni young man who was involved in the government who had to negotiate with Sunni insurgents to release my aunt's husband who had been kidnapped and threatened to be killed. And they had been married for 25 years or whatever it was, and these issues weren't discussed in the household. And when he approached my grandfather for my aunt's hand in marriage, it wasn't an issue. But this is not to say that we should take the simplistic view that this divide didn't exist. I think the divide did exist, but it wasn't the primary identifier or the primary issue that people identified with in terms of their identity. The Iraqi identity was there. And the biggest evidence for that, in my mind, continues to be that if you ask, we always talk about the Iraqi Shia in Iran, but if you ask the vast majority of Iraqi Shia in Iraq how they feel about Iran, you will actually hear some very interesting answers because they feel like they were treated very badly by the Iranians and have a very negative view. I think that we did amplify that division, and we amplified very strange divisions on the governing council when we created it. The Kurds and the Sunnis, for example. We say we're creating this, but the Kurds are Sunni. The vast majority of Kurds are Sunni. And then even the Shia parties are parties that were from the outside of Iraq or fostered outside. And the last thing I'll say here is the biggest Ba'ath party organization, you know where it was? Sadr City. The biggest Ba'ath party membership was in Sadr City, Baghdad. And if you're not aware, because, this is history now, making me feel a little bit old, but Sadr City was where Muqtada al-Sadr, I'm sure you all have heard of his name, this was a very large Shia population of Baghdad. It's in the eastern part of Baghdad, and probably 95% of the population of that city was Shia. But they were the largest Ba'ath. The Ba'ath party being what Saddam was in charge of during his reign over Iraq.
Thank you. There's a microphone on this side too. Please line up. I'll ask one more question and then we go directly to the students. And my question is this. why has nobody ever been held to account for these unending wars, as they're called, without results? And why has anybody ever held to account? And let me start with Mr. Vasevich to answer that, and then the other two, Ms. Sky and Mr. King, can join in, and then we'll go to you.
Well, it's a very good question, and I don't believe I have an adequate answer. I think the closest I can come is to say that within the policy elite, Republican, Democrat, senior professional military officers, the other people who make their living within the Beltway, there is a common mindset. And the common mindset is one that believes without reservation that both that the United States needs to remain the most powerful nation on the planet, and also that power is measured primarily in military terms. So while it is true, at least in my judgment, that the invasion and subsequent occupation of Iraq, a particular subject of this panel, were catastrophically stupid, nonetheless, that stupidity stems from this common mindset, this collective view. So in our political establishment, in our national security establishment, there is virtually no one who is willing to render a fundamental critique, that is to say, a critique that goes beyond what happened in Iraq, to examine why we get to Iraq in the first place. And as long as, I mean, there are people who offer that critique, but they're marginalized. You know, they publish books and op-eds that don't get read, don't matter. But there will be no accountability until there is a willingness on the part of the people in the political establishment, those elites, to take into account the possibility that the fundamentals informing our national security policy may themselves be wrong.
So, Ms. Sky, if you would briefly handle it, and then we'll go to the students, and I'll start with you, Mr. King, for an answer. Please.
So, in the UK, in stark contrast from the US, there has been large public demand for accountability. There has been an inquiry that was established that published its results a year or so ago, the Chilcot Inquiry, that interviewed everybody involved in the run-up to the war, the decision-making, and the failure of the aftermath. That report came out. It was very scathing in its findings. Prime Minister Blair, former Prime Minister Blair, cannot show his face in public in the UK. There are demands from the public and also from politicians that he be tried for war crimes. That's not possible, but that just gives you an idea of the sentiment. So the impact of the Iraq War has really been far-reaching. It has led to a trust in a distrust of elites and their ability to make the right decisions. In the whole discussions in the run-up to Brexit, you heard people say, why should we trust elites? It was elites who got us into the Iraq War. Why should we trust their ability to make the right judgments? So although the inquiry was not able to convict people, that's not what it was set up to do, it certainly was there to make sure that everybody understood what went wrong and why, that there is a public record on that. That has led to changes in the way the processes and policies are made in the UK, there has been a dramatic downsizing of the British military. So the British military will no longer be able to be involved in occupations overseas again. And the ghosts of the Iraq War linger on. So when there was a vote in Parliament over whether the UK should do anything about Bashar Assad's use of chemical weapons, the MPs, very aware that they had voted in support of the Iraq War, voted against doing anything to stop Bashar Assad using chemical weapons. And that decision in the British Parliament had big effects over here. When President Obama, who kind of got everybody lined up to respond militarily to the chemical attacks in Syria, withdrew that decision following the vote in the British Parliament and punted it off to Congress, knowing full well that Congress would never get around to making a decision on anything.
Thank you. Let's go there and be alternate. Please tell us who you are. Keep the comments and introduction short. Go ahead, please.
Thank you, sir. I'm Cadet Master Sergeant Shane Hutchins, class 19. So my question for the panel is, well, the U.S. has successfully rebuilt defeated nations before. Given an unlimited amount of time and all of the resources that the United States can muster, what, in your opinion, would it take to turn the turn Iraq into a stable, prosperous, democratic nation? Or is it too late for that at this point? Have we given over to self-rule? Is that not our purview anymore?
So, Mr. King, let's start.
I think the first thing to realize is that the U.S. military did exactly what it's designed to do. We decisively defeated the military in another country. We won the war. We did not secure the victory. We did not bring the resources of the United States to bear to bring Iraq around to be the nation that we envisioned it to be. Some of the mistakes we made were early on is that we believed that Jeffersonian democracy was the way. Democracy is relevant to what their society can take. The other thing is that we wanted to bring around an Anglo-Saxon capitalism economy, and it wasn't designed for that. Marxist socialism economy probably would have been better in that regard. It is a sovereign nation now, and they're going to have to make their own decisions. We're not going to change it. The democracy that they have is what they choose to have. How they decide to run their constitution or comply with their constitution is up to them. But we need to be there and be prepared to provide whatever assistance that they think is necessary from us and realize that the influence of Iran and other countries, Turkey in particular, right now in the north, is something that we have to take into consideration.
I'll let one more panelist answer that before we go to the question here, please.
I'm actually going to ask you to challenge the premise of your question. And the reason I ask you to do that is the question is, are we capable of doing something to make Iraq into a democracy or successful? I think you used the word successful democracy. I wrote that down, sorry. I may have misquoted you, but I mean, essentially, you're going to have to reoccupy the country because, as Alan just said, Iraq is now an independent nation. But I think the premise behind the question is what we really need to ask ourselves as Americans, and that is, are we capable of doing that, or are we simply trying to imprint our will, or what we perceive to be the proper country, onto that nation, or any other for that matter? And if we look at our history, how many successful times, how many times have we done that successfully? You know, there's a couple of them, but when you look at the vast majority of wars that we've waged in our history, those successful models start to look sparse. And I think that, as Alan said, We have to look at the full spectrum of what we're capable of doing and what we're not. We shouldn't be asking our military to become the one and only tool of diplomacy, nation building, emergency relief, name it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's go here.
Good afternoon. My name is John King. I'm a sophomore on the Corps of Cadets. And I apologize if my question won't be necessarily geared more towards Iraq, but more forward-thinking towards Syria. My personal opinion is that our country has become one of half measures. We start something, and as you said, Mr. King, our military does exactly what it's intended to do, decisively defeats the enemy. But we lack the conviction to finish our mission and actually follow through, whether that be we create a power vacuum and then we don't fill the vacuum, and then that's a radicalization instead of creates more problems for us. So looking forward to Syria, do you believe that we have an imperative, whether that be a more romanticized notion that we should be global police and like a tool for good, if you will, do we have any real moral imperative to actually join conflict there, as our president is very bombastically regarded? I don't really have a very strong opinion either way. I just believe that I'm not educated enough to form one, so I'd like to know what any of you think regarding that.
Ms. Skye, would you like to go over then?
And I want to just refer back to the last question as well, because we're talking about 15 years after the invasion of Iraq. You have to look at what happened during that period. Do you honestly think the Iraqis are saying, oh, Americans, please come back and give us democracy? They didn't exactly say it the first time. So when you look today at Syria, you have to look at where we're at. And the Syrian war has been going on for 6 years. And you could say that that war is pretty much coming to an end now. Why has it lasted so long? It lasted so long because so much external interference from different countries, including us. We gave enough support to the opposition so we couldn't lose, but we didn't give enough support so we could win. And so this civil war has continued for 6 years. We've got Iran involved, Russia involved, the Gulf countries, Turkey, everyone involved. 500,000 Syrians have been killed. Half the population of Syria is displaced from its home. So we're hardly at a position to start thinking about should the US invade or not. This discussion about should we drop a few bombs just to make ourselves feel, I don't know, some catharsis or something. But when you look at where Syria is at today, there are very different options from where it was at 6 years ago or 4 years ago. And I think today you just want the war, the fighting, the killing to come to an end.
So, doing research, I was born in 1998, and I'm currently 20 years old. My birthday was yesterday, so for around just over 85% of my life. Thank you! I really appreciate that. But to the point, just for over 85% of my life and the life of my peers, our country's been at war. So I was just wondering if any of you thought there was some legitimate imperative that we actually take action, or whether or not there was legitimacy to the claims that Bashar al-Assad did actually use chemical weapons on us. Constituents, or if that was a rebel ploy to try to get us to be more involved. I definitely agree with you that we shouldn't feel compulsion to spread democracy at the barrel of a gun. But I was just hoping for a more developed narrative whether or not there is a legitimate reason for us to go.
Mr. Basevich, you want to try that? Ms. Skye was pretty precise on it.
Are you implying that I won't be precise?
No, I picked you because I thought you might be precise in the opposite way.
Well, I'll dissent a little bit, I think, with my colleague in his judgment of U.S. military efforts, whether in Iraq or elsewhere in the greater Middle East. The war is a political act. It really doesn't matter how many battles you win. Victory requires achieving your political purposes. Real victory requires achieving your political purposes expeditiously and at a reasonable cost. Now, if you would accept that sort of definition of success, you don't have to. then it seems to me pretty plain that virtually all of our post-9/11 military efforts, whether in Iraq or Afghanistan or Libya or Somalia or Yemen or wherever you want to point to, they have uniformly failed. And indeed, it seems to me, this gets back to the accountability question and the sort of thing that the Chilcot Commission did, there is a crying need for us in this country to have a serious effort to understand why the greatest military in the world has not achieved its purposes. But your question, I think, on Syria was really getting to the moral question. And you made reference to a moral obligation to the Iraqi people. I must say I'm somewhat torn by that. But what I would say is, to the extent that we have a moral obligation to Syrians, then the action we take to acquit that moral obligation should be actions that address the problem. And the problem is the plight of these people who have been caught in this civil war year after year, hundreds of thousands of them displaced. And it's beyond me how any military action undertaken by the United States, short of invading and occupying the country for the next several decades, it's beyond me how any military action can actually acquit that moral obligation. Well, what could we do? What could we do to address the suffering of the Syrian people? Oh, here's an idea. Why don't we allow the displaced Syrians to come to the land of the free and the home of the brave? We have a very big country. We actually could accommodate a couple more refugees from Syria. And that would have a very direct, immediate, and practical benefit to the people who have suffered. Now, please raise your hand if you think that the majority of our fellow citizens would subscribe to a program bringing several hundred thousand displaced Syrians to live in the United States of America.
So let's have a show of hands. How many would believe that?
Two. Three. Okay. That seems to me about right. Yeah. Like 497 to three.
Thank you. Let me, I'll come back.
Thank you very much.
In the interest of time, we take two questions from you and you, and then try to feed those. Okay, so you go first.
Good afternoon. My name is Brian Phelps, and Mr. Basevich, I read your book. And in the first couple pages...
I don't want to be a smart aleck, but which book?
First of all, it was the War for Greater Middle East. And in the first couple pages, you decide, or not decide, you say, that the tactics and strategy of the U.S. Armed Forces going into Iraq was... Originally, they decided to uphold law, and they wanted to promote the overall security of the country. And instead, we went in with kind of an opposite of that, and we wanted to rescue. Say that in like the first couple pages. And when I was reading that, I thought about it, and it kind of made sense, but I was just wondering if you could elaborate on that, just on like the specifics. Because when I was thinking about it, if we're there to promote law and we're there to view the overall security of the country, isn't that rescuing it? That just it didn't really make sense to me.
So hang on a second, Andy. Let's take this question here.
My name is Taylor Ricky. I'm class of 2019, junior. And my question really pertains to not the military standpoint of protecting Iraq now. We're seeing more of like Turkey, how... It's Turkey and Iran are basically trying to have this ideology of, hey, let's put a proxy government, should I say, inside of Iraq now to gain their sphere of influence, should I say. And I was wondering what is your guys' concerns in regards to this, because I know for Turkey, should I say, you have Erdogan, who basically has this ideology of, hey, let's go back to the same ideology of Ataturk, where we should possibly bring a sense of the Ottoman Empire back. And Seeing that Iraq is in such a standpoint of the Middle East, do you believe that something like this ideology will bring another conflict or a different presence inside of the Middle East on a global scale?
Okay, so I let Mr. Basevich answer the question about the book. You'll have to buy 5 copies after his answer. And then Mr. King, you can feed the second question.
I honestly don't remember writing that. And I have a feeling that if I did, I may have been trying to be ironic. Let me try to get to the question, though. The key point here is that, in my judgment, we went to war in Iraq not because Iraq posed any kind of a threat to the United States. We went to war with Iraq because Iraq was weak, vulnerable. You know, we kicked their army around in 1991. The country had been under strict sanctions ever since. Although nobody was paying attention, the United States, sometimes with British help, had been bombing Iraq through most of the 1990s on a persistent basis, not large-scale bombing. But basically, Iraq had become a very weak military power. So we invaded because it was weak. We invaded because a coalition of neoconservatives and hardcore realists, people like Wolfowitz would have been in the neoconservative camp, people like Rumsfeld and Cheney would be in the hardcore realist camp. That coalition persuaded President George W. Bush, who had persuaded himself after 9/11, Bush is a serious believer, persuaded himself after 9/11 that he had been anointed by God to transform that part of the world. So that coalition chose to invade Iraq because they expected an easy win, and because they expected an easy win in Iraq, basically to position the United States, to increase our leverage, to increase our influence, so that we could move beyond the transformation of Iraq, assumed to be easy, in order to bring about change elsewhere in the region. Now, whether the result would have been, Wolfowitz would have hoped, a bunch of liberal democracies, or whether the result would have been, this is what Cheney and Rumsfeld would have hoped, basically American hegemony, unquestioned American hegemony, in either case, there would have been great benefits to the United States of America. So the invasion, of course, the invasion is conducted using the most recent precepts of conventional warfare, emphasizing the use of precision-guided munitions with almost zero thought given to what's going to happen after we get to Baghdad. And we got to Baghdad. It was really great. And then everything fell apart. Now, who's at fault for that? I have to say, I believe the principal responsibility for that failure was a military responsibility. The senior officers planning that operation didn't give any serious thought to what was going to happen once the Saddam Hussein regime was overthrown. And that then created the opportunity for all that ensued.
I've got to follow up to that question because I was the first civil military officer in Baghdad. And the night that I arrived on April the 8th, 2003, they came up to me and said, there is no reconstruction plan for Baghdad. You have 24 hours to come up with a plan. So 5.5 million people with no civil society, no functioning government. I was fortunate that my mentors before, for the last 10 years before that, had been military governors in World War II, and I had listened and labored over their stories. And I fell back on their stories and said in 96 hours, focus on 4 primary areas: public safety, fire and police, public health, hospitals, public utilities, electric and water, and public administration. Call everybody back to work. And we debated long that night about calling Baptists back, and my final argument was that they show up with just arrest them. And in fact, we did. Number 26 on the deck of cars on the way back to work, and we arrested them. In 13 days, we had 97 hospitals up and operating. We had 5,000 policemen armed and back to work. We had 1,500 firemen back on the job, 25 of the 100 emergency vehicles back in operation. And then Orma showed up, and they said, stop, stop. We want to do a two-week assessment.
Sorry, who showed up?
Orma, the Office of Reconstruction Humanitarian Assistance. So Orma shows up, and they said, we want to do this reevaluation. I can tell you where it's at today, and the only question that was asked of me in my handoff, the only question was, how many women are on the police force? That was the only question. And I said, ma'am, I don't know the answer to that. I suspect zero. Well, that's the most important thing that we've got to focus on right now. We don't have a distribution system for food. We don't have the sewage working. The water is not, taken care of. We don't have, all these other functional things, and that was the only question that was of concern. And that's why I said we didn't bring the resources to bear. We did the best that we could do in the amount of time that we had. Granted, the higher levels did not plan. With that being said, I'll answer your question, but a quick prelude to that. Just a show of hands, how many believe the Islamic State is a terrorist group? And that's why we lose our war. The Islamic State is not a terrorist group. They're an insurgency. Insurgencies want to take over a government. Terrorists want to change policy. And Obama fought the Islamic State in Syria as a counterterrorism operation. That was a counterterrorism strategy. You kick in doors, take them to jail. Counterinsurgency is you look them in the face, shake their hand, and drink tea. It's a big difference. And so for us, we've got to be able to do that first. With you, every country is going to try to influence other countries, particularly their neighbors. We do it in Mexico, we do it in Canada. We still try to do it in the UK since 1776. So Iran's going to do it to Iraq, and I will tell you that a very, very senior official once told me, he was a Shia, and we were talking about the influence of Iran, and he said, listen, you're going to leave. Your history shows you're going to leave. And who are we going to look to? Are we going to look to our Saudi neighbor for help? The only person we have to look to is to Iran. And that's sort of where it left it at. Sorry for the long answer.
No, thank you very much. So I'm going to take two more questions. And if you will, Ms. Sky, you will answer the first one, and you will answer the second one. So in the interest of time, short questions, short answers. Let's start there.
Hi, my name is Chris Williams. I'm a junior, and I, too, am in the Corps. I'm going to talk about Mr. Hickey's questions, because he alluded to them, and in that there's a lot of cultural change in younger generations, specifically like millennials era. In that they grew up in a country that's always at war with the same people, it's always the same people in the news. So there's a lot of apathy or apathetic individuals, and there's a lot of people that care about it, but a lot more that are used to or just have gotten fed up with it and kind of don't do much. So what would you say to someone that doesn't care about the Iraq mess, just kind of sitting in their mother's basement and play video games kind of thing? What would you say to them to make them care about this again? Or should they not care?
So, Ms. Sky, you want to take this, and then we'll come back to Mr. Sayre.
Can I make a stab while she's thinking about it? Your taxes are going up. You know, by the way, report to the draft board. A lot of people care.
You know, America has been at war, as you said, since you were very young. But America's forever at war and never winning, and it makes no difference to Americans. It's only 1% that serve. Tiny. And that's kind of like genetically reproduced. Americans' taxes didn't go up. It really makes no difference. They just say thank you at the football games, go first onto the planes, and that's about it. So, you've got to wonder what has happened that we have a whole war economy, that we can just keep going, that the outcome of the wars doesn't really affect most, vast majority of Americans at all. Jobs in every state are dependent on the defense industry. We are gutting our diplomatic service. That's getting smaller and smaller and smaller. But the military budget, the military is getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And I worried when I was, you know, the early questions that said, you know, how are we going to use the US military budget to build schools in Iraq? Or deal with mental health problems in Iraq? This is kind of getting out of control. And we're in danger of being forever at war, never winning, and not really understanding what the future threats to us are. Nobody's going to invade America. War of the future will be in cyber. If you want to attack America, you take down the critical infrastructure. You have tanks on tanks. And so, for you millennials, you've got to be asking questions about this. How did we end up perpetually at war? And that's the question you need to ask. Why are we forever at war? And why are we never winning?
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Greg Sander from Virginia and the Corps of Cadets. I personally see a lot of parallels between the Vietnam War and the war in Iraq and Afghanistan. The biggest one being, it seems like we're fighting a conventional war with purely conventional methods. We've had huge success in conventional warfare in Afghanistan and Iraq with, like you mentioned, war soldiers. Jim Gant had a lot of success. And I feel like we just keep repeating the same mistakes. I'm curious if we're ever going to learn in the future and take care of the conflict in a different manner. Learn from our neighbors, for example, First Vallejo, that kind of insurgency.
I got this question yesterday, and you've got a great professor here that can probably answer it for you. You talked to David Albert. But, you know, are we ever going to learn our lesson? I think you all are going to answer that question, right? The fact that 15 years later, by the way, for that young man whose birthday was yesterday, the 20th birthday, 3 days ago, it was the 15th anniversary of when that soldier started to put that American flag on the statue of Saddam Hussein, and then they put the Iraqi flag thereafter, and that statue came down. And if you read the Iraqi press, all of it was about that, and I challenge you to find articles in our newspapers about that 15 years ago. Because it was such an important date in our history now. But how much did you read about it? And I think the fact that, you know, Professor Morris and President Schneider and this university putting on a panel like this and bringing you all to reflect and bringing, you know, distinguished panelists to talk about this is a great way at least to begin to institutionalize some of that knowledge. And I think that's what really needs to happen is the institutionalization of the lessons learned. I'm not a military person. You know, I was intrigued by the TAP ceremony last night, first one I attended, so thank you for that honor. But the question that I send back to you all and to, you know, the leadership of the military is, are we institutionalizing the lessons learned? And if we're not, why? Because it seems like, you know, we went through some of this in Vietnam, right? We went through, we learned a lot in Iraq. And if you speak to Duke DeLuca yesterday, he talked about some of the units institutionalizing, but not the system as a whole. And I think that's very problematic. But if you'll allow me just to touch on the last question very quickly also, on the Turkey-Iran question that was asked. I think this is a direct result of the almost fading of Pax Americana. I think when we look back at history, we'll see that this coming period, maybe this coming century is not our century. And the question and the challenge that we need to face is how we deal with that. Because we are pulling back, right? If you look at our current administration and the administration before that, we are kind of saying we've had enough of the world. world, deal with your own problems. And the question now becomes is how do we deal with that challenge when we decide that we're not going to play anymore? Good luck.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, I'm Mike Bernard, freshman of Orbidez class of 2021. My question is, in America we often say that we are a shining city on a hill, a beacon of freedom to others, but there are plenty of people that sit at the bottom of that hill that look up and look at this great freedom. And in nations like Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan, Sudan, where we've destroyed those nations, and kids go out in the streets and they see bomb strapped on that says property in the United States, is it America's duty, is it America's job to take care of this lost generation? Let them come over here and give them the childhood that they never had.
Who would like to answer that? Before I do, hurry up.
Please, I'm actually going to offer you an economic answer. You know, Andrew was talking about whether we want to bring Syrian refugees here. Let me postulate that 150,000 Syrian refugees, from an economic standpoint, are going to cost us a lot less than sending any bombs that cost us a million, how many million apiece for each missile, or, you know, whatever it takes to send a carrier group, or whatever it may be. And I wonder whether we shouldn't start thinking along those lines. Turkey has taken in a million refugees. I don't know what the number is. It's maybe more than a million. Germany's got a million. And yet, if you look at the G20 economies last year, Turkey had the highest growth rate of the G20 economies. It was 7.3%, their GDP growth rate. Ours was 2.3%. So, and they've taken in a lot of refugees from Syria.
Please. Hello, my name is Ben Ferguson. And Mr. King, you alluded to my question earlier, but to my knowledge, the original plan during the invasion of Iraq was go in, not disable the government or the military, get rid of a few Baptist ministries, but for the most part, leave it functioning. And then the State Department came in and decided to tear it all down and build from the ground up. Were there any positive outcomes from that choice, short term, and nowadays, is Iraq still feeling any repercussions, positive or negative, from that choice?
If you want someone specific to answer that from the panel, go.
Anyway.
In the short case.
There was actually a State Department program called the Futures of Iraq. And they had been put together for a couple of years before the invasion. And they had gone all over the world and found technocrats to be able to go in and this government in a box and fulfill the ministries. So the actual idea was to take it all the way down, take away the Baptists and start back from the beginning. The way I understood it, we were supposed to be there for 6 months, and then they would bring in these technocrats, transition out, and we would move on. And the Iraqi people quickly made it known to us that that was not what they wanted. And then things changed, so that Office of Reconstruction and Humanitarian Assistance I spoke of quickly went away. And then the Coalition of Provisional Authority came in with Ambassador Bremer. And he had his edicts. He takes a lot of kicks for what he did. But remember, as a follower, there's always a boss. And he was fulfilling what had come out of Washington. He and I were together in October of 2012, and the question was posed in a forum like this, you know, if there's anything he could have done different, what would that have been? And his comment was, I don't think we should have disbanded the military. That was probably the most destructive thing that we did to that country, because it took, you know, a couple million people that had been trained to kill people and break things and set them out to do just that. And then we tried to believe that the insurgency wasn't taking place, that what we were going to bring to them was so great that people would love us for it and it would take hold. So are the regrets or the things that the Iraqis probably wish hadn't happened? There are some people that wish the Dominic was still there, unfortunately.
So we are starting to run short of time, and our fearless leader here, President Snyder, you personally have to answer to him if you don't keep the proper time. So I'm going to take two questions. The people behind, if you would just come up after the event, I'm sure the panelists will be able to answer your questions. So I'm going to take your question, a quick one, your question, a quick one, and Miss, if you would just come up off it. Please, one, two.
Hi, Staff Sergeant Cadet Hughes. I have written down a question on my phone. So my question is, why do the U.S. leaders believe it is our obligation to impose our Western politics on countries that don't want to adopt the democratic style of government? And why do we continue to use our military as a police force to protect countries that obviously don't want our assistance?
Ms. Sky, you want to have a shot at that?
I think that's a great question. A really good question. Yes, partly it's because the U.S. is all-powerful, but also partly, you know, you think of all the problems internal to America, the problems that we don't deal with. So you can look at infrastructure, you look at gun crimes, you look at all of this. And if somebody is killed by somebody who happens to be Muslim, then all hell breaks loose. And sometimes it's easier to deal with things overseas than it is to deal with things at home. And so we've always got people diverting attention overseas for whatever reasons. It's a way to drum up support domestically. And the fear of terrorism is blown way, way, way out of proportion. You're more likely to be killed by your sofa than you are by somebody who is an Islamist terrorist. More likely to be killed by a beast sting. So it is blown way, way, way out of proportion, and all resources are suddenly thrown at this thing that creates a whole new set of problems.
So Ms. Sky, take your time. I was just looking at my watch and the program, and in fact, I hear you speak to me. So take the time, and the people who are lining up, come on back. Sorry about that. Go ahead. Okay.
How many of you have heard of Dwight D. Eisenhower? Have you read his last speech as President of the United States of America? What did he warn us about?
Military-industrial complex.
And I challenge you as cadets to actually think about that from a president, celebrated military man who turned to civilian life and had this prescient look to the future of our country, and whether we need to act upon what President Eisenhower was talking about back in
61.
The historian,
thank you. So now that we have a few more minutes, I do want to, all of you seem to be touching on the issue that the United States does not go to war for really for anything to be accomplished, but just seeing if we go to war just to keep the economy going or the defense industry going. I mean, is that where things have come to? Am I describing this properly? Are you asking these students to be thinking about this so that as they get into more important positions, you know, I'm reminded of the previous Secretary Gates, who said, why is it that we have more musicians in the army than we have foreign service officers in the diplomatic corps? This is the defense sector. Go ahead.
Well, there are one of the reasons it's so difficult to come to grips with this penchant for war is that there are a variety of factors. It's not like there's one single cause, and we can just address that as the problem itself. But I think that one of the contributing causes is American history. American history as we choose to remember American history. The pieces of American history we choose to either forget or place on the margins. I was born in 1947. Both my parents were World War II veterans. And lately, I've come to reflect on the continuing centrality of World War II as an event that continues to define our sense of who we are and the role we are to play in the world. Now, even our memory of World War II is radically distorted. I mean, if you had to pick one country and say, that's the country that defeated the Nazis, who would that be?
Soviet Union,
right? This alliance we made with the mass murderer, Joseph Stalin, was crucial to bringing about the victory against the Germans. That's not how we remember it. We remember it. My parents remembered it, remembered the war as the absolute vindication of this country. This was when we demonstrated our capacity to liberate. And in the wake of 1945, we demonstrated our capacity, came to believe, to democratize. You know, our recollection of the post-war occupation of Germany and of Japan is that we brought democracy to them. We don't credit them with having anything to do with that, even though it was actually their choice and their leaders who had so much to do with that. And my point would be that here in the 21st century, with all that has happened since World War II, certainly Vietnam, the larger experience of the Cold War, with all the miscalculations and moral compromises, certainly post-9/11 wars, we ought to arrive at a common historical narrative. It doesn't abandon World War II. It doesn't dismiss it as a non-event. But now places World War II in a much broader context, and quite frankly, a more complicated context. Complicated both in terms of U.S. interests, U.S. actions, and the moral consequences that have stemmed from them. So we need to rethink our history.
Right here, go ahead.
Hello, my name is
Isabel
Moss. I'm a sophomore in class of 2020. My question, so we've touched on the argument that the U.S. needs to fix what we broke in Iraq, and that implies that we still have work to do, that we still have to help Iraq rebuild. And we've also touched on the fact that there are other conflicts that are more pressing. And the question is, with all of these growing issues that some of you are taking precedence over this conflict, what still needs to be done from us, and what should we expect Iraq to be held responsible for? As we face these new threats to our nation.
Anyone?
I mean, Iraq's in a different place at the moment. It's heading towards elections, May the 12th. And it's a fundamental crossroads. It's a defining moment again for the country, similar to what happened in 2010. And, there is still a threat from terrorism. ISIS has been defeated, but there's still aspects of ISIS around. But the bigger challenge is from the governance of the country itself. It's from corruption. It's in the top five most corrupt countries in the world. It's from its poisonous politics. So these are the issues that Iraq is grappling with. And, that's a really difficult thing for outside countries to try and help. We have spent billions in Iraq. In Afghanistan, we spent more than the Marshall Plan for Europe. So we're not talking about us underspending. We have spent billions in these countries. And why is there so little to see from it? Partly it's because the way in which we spend money, there's a whole problem with how we contract, lots of problems. So a good question would be, why would you keep throwing money at stuff? So what can we help Iraqis with? There's still some training that is useful for their military forces. And that training can be provided by US forces, a small contingent, as advisors, or through NATO. And that's in discussion. There's also, a useful role for American companies to invest. get the private sector going. That is really critical. It's going to come from businesses investing. Iran invests a lot. Turkish companies invest a lot. You want the private sector to go that way. We are not in the business anymore of occupying that country or controlling anything. But there's useful things that we can do to show that we're still helping, that we're useful. But that helps balance Iran. Because Iraq is a battlefield between the Iranians on one hand and the Saudis on the other. They instrumentalize religion to try and fight each other. So the US, just by training military, by getting companies to invest there, can help Iraq move forward. But Iraqi's fate is in Iraqi's hands.
You know, one of the...
I'm going to give you a personal example because this is something I saw. In 2007, it was earlier than that, my partners, my business partners, who at the time weren't my business partners, had a project to do a water treatment plant in Sadr City. Okay? This was a project that was U.S. funded, and that project was given, if I recall the numbers correctly, I may be off by a couple numbers, but it's not significant, but if I remember correctly, it was given to a U.S. company for something like $80 million. And that U.S. company contracted it to another U.S. company for something like $67 million. And that company contracted it to a Kuwaiti company for about $48 million. And it contracted it to my business partner's firm for $18 million. And my business partner put the best material in, and it only cost $13 million. Okay, so we went from $13 million all the way up to 80-something, which was what was billed to the U.S. Treasury. And this is a problem that we really need to figure out and face, and I think part of what SIGR's responsibility at the time was to look at some of this, the Inspector General for Iraq Reconstruction. So that's a lesson that we need to learn. The other comment that I want to add is if you ask any Iraqi today, what did the British leave for Iraq? As bad as the British experience was for the Iraqis, but they will still recall fondly that the British left the railroads. Ask any Iraqi, and they'll tell you the British left the railroads in Iraq, and they have this good feeling that this is something that is still being used today. Ask any Iraqi, what did we as Americans leave in Iraq? And you will not find an answer. That's a problem.
Mr. Lucid, space is yours.
So our event is focused on Iraq, so it's not surprising. The question comes up, what should we do for Iraq? But let me complicate the question a little bit. Because Iraq is not the only country on the planet where we may have some unpaid debts. How do we establish the priorities? In that regard, I mean, if the American people were in fact willing to acquit that responsibility, should Iraq become, in front of Afghanistan, a country that we destabilized back in the 1980s before abandoning after the Soviets withdrew? Should Afghanistan come before the Central American republics, which during the first half of the 20th century were effectively American protectorates, where we threw in with corrupt dictators whose presence we felt served our interests? What do you read in the papers today about Honduras, or Guatemala, or El Salvador? Do we have some responsibility for that? How about the people of Vietnam? If you read the papers, you know in Vietnam, there's still people regularly being injured as a result of unexploded ordnance, bombs that we dropped that didn't explode, that cover large parts of the country. What's our debt to the Vietnamese? What
what's our debt to the Native Americans? Maybe that debt should come first. They were here first. We took their country. So I am not trying to suggest that we should not discuss seriously what our debt to the Iraqi people may be, but I would argue strongly that that discussion needs to be broader, because they're not the only ones who have claims.
Thank you. Right there. Good afternoon. I'm Cadet Private Carlson, Norwich University Corps Cadets. And this is a question primarily directed to Mr. Basevich. Earlier on, you spoke of the concept of American exceptionalism and how it's gotten us into situations we are in today in Iraq. What steps can be taken to essentially challenge this so we don't end up in future situations similar to where we are today?
I think the first step that you should take, you young people, is to read the following book. It's called The Irony of American History, published in 1952 by Reinhold Niebuhr, theologian, public intellectual. Most important book ever written about U.S. foreign policy, because it probes these internal, ideological, quasi-religious origins of U.S. policy and warns against them. So that's my answer. Read Niebuhr and think about him.
Good afternoon. My name is Dylan Ryan from class of 2020. Recently, I watched a documentary from 2007 called No End in Sight, which talked about the early days of the Iraqi occupation. In it, they talked about how while America was there, while there was no police or government official force in place, Americans and the American government and military decided to guard areas like oil facilities and oil refineries instead of places like government buildings and national museums that held artifacts dating back to the early days of human civilization. In the early days of the occupation, looting took place, and many of these priceless artifacts were destroyed and stolen. This kind of looks back at the idea of culture and the idea that the Iraqis looked at America not there to maintain law and order, but there to maintain the oil fields. What was the impact of culture and the abandonment of culture for America in Iraq, and how can we kind of fix this problem going forward if that ever presents itself again?
Mr. King?
When we first arrived in Baghdad, that was when I was doing the nightly news conferences, that was the question that kept coming up, that and the zoo. But I will tell you, after having met the curator of the museum, in anticipation of us coming, most of the artifacts were removed from the museum before we got there. And speaking to him later on, there were only like 32 or 37 that were destroyed or stolen that were truly irreplaceable. The ones that were left behind were counterfeits, and we found them all over the country afterwards. And they had been marked. They were counterfeit to art that they had taken out of the markets, and they left them in the vaults, and that's what actually was stolen. For us, when you get there and you have so many troops, and you have so many buildings and other infrastructure that has to be secured, you've got to secure what is the most likely to be damaged. And we tried to secure the water sites and some of the police and fire areas that had vehicles, but there just wasn't enough troops to go around. And I got beat up one night on the news. They asked me, they said, what are you doing about the weapons in the city? What are you doing? And I said, well, there's 7 million AK-47s in Baghdad, and there's 5.5 million people. So the math says that every man, woman, and child has one, and hope you have two. What do you want me to do? And the guy said, well, where did you get that information? I said, I don't know. I read one of your newspapers this morning. And he said, well, we're not credible sources. I said, can I quote you on that? But afterwards, as I walked out, one of the newscasts hit me up and he said, what are you doing about the zoo? What are you going to do about the zoo? And I said, you know what I'm going to do about the zoo? I'm going to go open the cages, and in 2 weeks I'll go back and figure out what to do about the zoo. We have 97 hospitals operating. We have no blood or oxygen. People are dying in front of them, and you're worried about the animals. And so that night they came back and said, coalition officials say there's no blood or oxygen in the city. People are dying. And so we had an influx of blood coming into the country, so much so that they were, he was spoiling the runway because he couldn't get it off. So my boss appreciated the diversion, but he asked me to talk it over with him in the future. But there was a plan. I was in touch with the curators of the museums, and I actually did confiscate some very valuable artifacts that dated back like 3200 BC that were returned to them. So it wasn't as many as were reported in the news.
I'm going to disagree with you. We destroyed the doors. We really did. And I'll tell you, from someone who had to work from a very small office shared by 10 people because the ministry that I was responsible for was burned to the ground, a ministry that had 158,000 Iraqi employees across Iraq, across 63 entities. But what I would postulate now is that if there wasn't so much taken, why didn't we have a handover from the U.S. government of all the artifacts that were taken, given to the Iraqi ambassador a few years back?
They were taken, don't get me wrong. But the curator had taken the majority of the most valuable ones away. And we recovered those from him about 3 months after the invasion. So.
But the other part of this is, if you go to the historic sites in Babylon, unfortunately, because of the lack of cultural training and having this wider view, our own troops were actually destroying some of Iraq's historic sites without realizing it. You know, we had tanks rolling over places that were immensely valuable from a historic standpoint. ISIS did what they did in the north to finish it off, if you will, in destroying the Nebi Yunus Mosque and the Hadba and other places. But I think what it tells us is that we really need to have a better understanding of where we're going before we go there. And I want to just take a minute here, because I think that we're also being very harsh. And I understand that may be the perception. And it's not to be harsh, it's so that we learn lessons, right? Because as I said in one of the earlier comments is, you all as cadets going into a military, you should be, as a military, only a certain part of the overall strategy of a nation in dealing with external issues. And I think the challenge for you all as you matriculate into your different positions is to always ask yourselves, are my perceptions correct, or am I just simply going along and not asking the right questions?
So we've been listening to this really terrific discussion for a little while. Don't go away unless you finish with your question, okay? But what I want is a show of hands. How many people now, after sitting an hour and a half here, believe the decision to go into Iraq was the right one? Let's have a show of hands.
Seven?
Not very many. Ask the right question.
Why would you say right or wrong? I mean, I think that's a right, because the question is, for someone whose family suffered under Saddam Hussein, I would tell you that absolutely yes. But then the other part of that is, did we do it right? And I think that's where it might be a challenge for a U.S. audience, right? But then I look at it from both of my identities, as an American and as someone who originally is from Iraq.
So then my question would be, would we want Saddam Hussein back again? Would the country be more stable? Would the country be out of war? What do you think? What about the other three panels? Would Saddam Hussein be better for Iraq today than what exists?
a failed state, radicals running all around, breaking up, people getting killed. Go ahead. I'd love to hear an answer, all three of you. Mr. King, Mr. Bacevich, and Mr. Scott.
I think you have to understand the rationale for the reason for going into Iraq. And the rationale for invading Iraq was the premise that Saddam had weapons of mass destruction. And in the panic and fear after 9/11, there was concern that those weapons of mass destruction would fall into the hands of terrorists. That was the premise. Now you could ask, how did we get to that premise? And when you look at the CIA's own report on this, which they made public years later, was they criticized themselves for lack of imagination. Because Saddam behaved in a manner that looked like he had weapons of mass destruction, everybody thought that maybe he did have weapons of mass destruction. But it was a deception strategy. He didn't want to get attacked by Israel or Iran. But he assumed that the US, with all the intel available, knew that he didn't have weapons of mass destruction. So that was going on. But the reason for invading Iraq, it wasn't a humanitarian intervention. It wasn't because we cared for the oppressed Iraqi people. Saddam had mass murdered his people for a long time. We supported Saddam during the Iran-Iraq war when he used chemical gas against the Iranians. No comment was made because he was our bad guy at the time. When he, you know, we had President Bush Sr. call for Iraqis to rise up after the 1990 intervention in Kuwait. He called for Iraqis to rise up and overthrow Saddam. And they rose up. And Saddam massacred 100,000 or so in the south. And the US did nothing. So we didn't go there as a humanitarian intervention. That was not the reason. And so we can't say, you know, would we be better off with Saddam or not? You have to have a reason to go to war. It's international law.
So the question is, what would have happened had we not invaded Saddam and stayed in power? And of course, the only answer is, who the hell knows? But the posing the question seems to presume that Saddam Hussein, or perhaps his sons, would today, 2018, still be in power. And that's certainly a possible outcome. But let us note that it is an outcome that, in a sense, denies any agency on the part of the Iraqi people. Assumes that no internal process could have occurred that would have overthrown the dictator. And that couldn't have been the case. On the other hand, we have seen in the not-so-distant past where people have risen up and overthrown the evil dictator. And I don't see any reason why we would necessarily assume that that couldn't have happened in Iraq had we not intervened.
On the distinguished colleagues, I mean, I can't know what I can add to it. I do say in my book that I think going into Iraq was the right thing to do based on the information and the reasons we went. That would have been the question I asked, was do you think going there was the right thing? The question I would have asked is, do you know why we went? Because I talk about it in the book. I was very fortunate. I caught, you know, people off the deck of cars, the infamous deck of cars that were, you know, the top most wanted people. The chairman of Atomic Energy, I surrendered to me. The Ministry of Industrial Affairs, Research and Development, scientists surrendered to me. And I got to hear all these stories. And Emma's exactly right. What they had told me was the night that we went into Iraq, the night we crossed the berm, Kim Al-Ali went to Saddam and said, "Uncle, what do I have? The infidels are here." And he said, "Get out of my office." And he said, "No, Uncle, not this time. What do I have to use for the infidels that are here? Where are the weapons at?" And Saddam dropped his head and he said, "I don't have anything." He said, "I only told these stories because I didn't want Iran in Israel to attack us. Because we have nothing." And so what he proved was he was a world-class propagandist. And we single-sourced most of the intelligence that we had, and that single source, which I got to track down a lot of the stuff that he had claimed, even about the downed pilot Spiker, was not true. And he was getting paid for that information that wasn't validated and sourced out. So Saddam needed to go. Did we need to do it? That's debatable. But he was a terrible dictator, and he killed a lot of people. And I got to witness with my own eyes the horror of what he did in some of the torture chambers. And so I say yes, but we need to know why.
Can I pose a question for Emma, please, with regard to weapons of mass destruction? And the question relates to the now famous meeting, I guess of what was called the War Cabinet, when the chief of, was it the chief of MI6, speaking with Blair and other members of the cabinet, stated that the intelligence is being fixed around the case. This is prior to the invasion. In other words, the senior-most members of the British government, not speaking to the press, but behind closed doors, stated that they knew that the argument being presented by U.S. officials about weapons of mass destruction was not true. I just wanted your evaluation of that episode and its significance.
So the correspondence you're referring to said that the U.S. was cherry-picking the information. And, you know, there was that whole build-up to the war. And that's the context where that correspondence was taking place. Because, you know, some will argue that there were efforts to try and prevent an intervention taking place by giving the weapons inspectors more time to prove that there weren't weapons of mass destruction. But on the whole, when you look at the intelligence community in the US and in the UK, the overall assessment was that Saddam had weapons of mass destruction. When it came to the argument that Saddam was in cahoots with Al-Qaeda, which was also being put forward by a particular American, senior American official, that was dismissed by most of the intelligence community. They said that is nonsense. That is being politically driven. But what happened on the WMD side is a real lesson in confirmation bias. When the guy at the top says, show me the evidence, then everybody down the line is looking for the evidence to pass up. And all the information that showed that there wasn't any didn't get passed up. So you guys, when you think in the future, when you have to set your commander's critical information requirements, be wary of confirmation bias. So don't just ask for what you think, ask also for what you don't think. So you can then assess was there evidence or not. But I think with this WMD, it was confirmation bias. And even within the British system, even though the guy was saying that they're cherry-picking, as in there is no doubt. And when you look at Colin Powell's testimony, when he talks about that, he says he wished he had caveated what he said much more, instead of speaking with such certainty. And Alan was referring to Curveball, this great source in inverted commas, who was like a fantasist. And he was paid for by the Germans, paid for by the Iranians, everybody was paying with him. And they interviewed him a couple of years ago. And they said, why did you lie? And he said, because I hated Saddam Hussein, and I would lie again. I would do anything to remove Saddam Hussein from power. So everybody was being played along there. And there was failures in leadership, failures in intel, and failures in imagination.
So I must say, quick one, please. We have 2-3 minutes left. This is, you need to be somewhat faster. Yes? Sorry.
Go ahead.
Michel Kadri, Professor of
professor of computer information systems with a 25-year history of interest in information warfare. What do you think the consequences have been in military activity since the Vietnam War of victimization of the ordinary, non-military people in the countries we have invaded in terms of recruitment for opposition forces?
I think it has contributed greatly to the recruitment of militants and terrorists and like people.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Let me now, I'm afraid this time for real, I need to wind this up. And lest we forget, we had a great ceremony last night. There are a number of wonderful Norwich University students who were killed in the Iraq War. And in your program, first page, inside, there's a poem. It's one of the most famous. It's a verse from one of the most famous poems that is often read at military funerals. And I'm going to read it. If you like it, you can join me. So it's for the fallen. They shall not grow as we that are left grow. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn, but the going down of the sun, and in the morning we will remember them. So I want to thank our panelists, our wonderful panelists, for coming here today, Mr. Salpadine, Mr. Andrew Basevich, Mr. Alan King, Emma Skye. I want to thank you all for coming. That ends this edition of the Colby panel.